Hello, I'm Steve Rakusik with South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
And I'm Dale Droege, Professor of Biology at Dakota State University.
And today we're going to dissect the...
Yellow perch.
Yellow perch.
Yeah, yellow perch belong to a group of fishes called the ray fin fishes. And you can see that here with the rays in their fins. And they're interesting because they're the largest group of vertebrates. There's more than 20,000 species of these, which is nearly three times the next largest group of vertebrates. So sometimes we don't appreciate that because of, you know, we don't see them so much because they live in the water, but they're a very diverse group. But if you think of all the coral reef fish and other types of deep fish or fish that live deep in the ocean, you know that there's a large number of these.
And then why select the yellow perch?
Well, the yellow perch, yellow perch for study is probably, it's easily obtainable, it's relatively cheap, it's good size, mm-hmm. pretty much, and the numbers are good, their abundance in nature is good, so we don't impact their populations.
And I'm feeling this before, there's definitely some spikes here.
As
compare this to a shark?
Yeah, a shark will have more fleshy fins, and something like a catfish, for example, or a minnow, have more soft rays, their fins would bend around. But a lot of these fish like these, a lot of the sport fish, bass, and these type of things are the ray fin fish, and they have these hard spines in many of their fins.
And as far as number of fins, or certain number of fins,
yeah.
Any names for them? I kind of
Externally, there's really, you know, it's pretty simple. The fins are the dorsal fin, which we're familiar with, like for sharks, on the back. And in the case of something like a walleye, it actually consists of two parts, but it is a single fin that just has two sections. And then we have the caudal fin, which is the tail. A lot of the pull, or a lot of the force for movement, comes from the caudal fin pushing against the water. And then the anal fin, which is down here near the cloaca, where the wastes come out. And then in many of the more what we consider advanced fishes, the pectoral fins up here in the front are raised up toward the middle of the body, and now the pelvic fins move forward. So you have this what's called the advanced ray fin fish fin arrangement, which is to have the pelvic and pectoral fins fairly close together. And they seems to be an advantage in maneuverability when they're, you know, when they're floating in the water, then they can turn more easily with that.
Now, I kind of look at this, is it speed? Is that what these help with as far as catching prey or anything? Or
I would say probably maneuverability. The speed would mostly come from the tail itself.
As far as catching food then, is there any special adaptations for that then?
Or? Yeah, and then here, as we can see in the mouth here, in the mouth's terminal, you can see it's a large mouth. One thing that's interesting about these kinds of fish is that you think about trying to capture something in water, if you try to grab it, how the water pushes it away from you. So what these fish actually do when they get up toward prey, I'll try to pull this down here, you can see the mouth extends out to large gape. And what that does is create a suction pressure and actually pulls small prey into their mouth. And they do this so fast you almost can't see it without a slow motion camera. But so it would come up, and so instead of grabbing things, instead more or less sucks them into its mouth.
So then eating, taking it whole, or is there any kind of chewing?
Yeah, not much chewing in fish. They pretty much just swallow it whole.
And then as far as a complete system,
yeah.
Is there like an anus then, or how does that work?
Yeah, it's a little different in fish. If you want to hold it there. The mouth, of course, comes in the food, goes through the digestive tract, and then there's the anus would be right inside of this opening, and so there's actually this hole here, this space here, is the common opening of both the reproductive tract and the digestive tract, and that's called the cloaca, which actually is Latin for sewer, which makes some sense when you think about it. So they have a single opening for those two systems. So really, it's only mammals that really have separate openings to the urinal system, urinary system, and the digestive system.
Okay. As you were opening that mouth, any kind of nostril up here, anything?
And we did forget that too. Yeah, there are a pair of nostrils, and they blend in pretty well, but they're right up here and here. And they do not go into the throat. They're just they're there for chemosensory purposes, like tasting or smelling, if you want to think of that, smelling the water. So they're sensitive to chemicals in the water.
So a pretty advanced nervous system then?
And they'd have a fairly large brain under here, all things considered. I mean, you know, compared to a mammal, maybe not that great, but mm-hmm. you know, compared to many other animals, they have a very large brain protected by a bony brain case and are capable of fairly sophisticated behavior.
Any other specialized structures as far as nervous system?
Along here, and this is peculiar to, or this is unique to fish, so only no other vertebrate has this. There's a line right along here. It's called the lateral line, and you can see it running. It's just a little bit different colored as it runs down the mid part of the body. And that is a very specialized structure for sensing pressure changes. So waves hitting up against it, something moving over here would create waves that then would the lateral line would sense, and so they would know there'd be some object to the one side of them. And so it's a sensory system that only works well in water.
A couple of things I noticed here, like as far as sight, I mean, there's large eyes.
Yeah, they have large eyes, good vision. Yeah, they depend a lot on vision and smell. So they're, you know, like most vertebrates, they have paired sense organs, paired nostrils, paired eyes, paired lateral lines and that, so they can tell which direction sensory information is coming from and respond accordingly.
You mentioned it's kind of a closed system. As far as there's no, in the lungs, there's no type, or no lungs,
yeah,
I guess.
Yeah, no lungs and gills, but it doesn't have to, they don't need, because there's so much water coming in, you know, they don't really need that connection to the throat.
But then how does, as far as breathing and stuff,
what's this? Yeah, and we were going to talk, one other structure we should probably look at here is this operculum. It's an important ray fin fish structure here. It's a bony flap that covers the gills.
Should I kind of pull it back?
Pull it back for that way we can look at the gills here a little bit. Okay. Kind of, I'll get my finger under there. Yeah, so you can see the gills lie under there. And it's a really strong bony flap, and it protects the gills, and it also works in breathing because fish have a system where they pull water into their throat, and they push it then over this way, and at the same time the gills open up like this, that suck water across. Mm. So they basically, these fish are pumping water over their gills, and that allows them to get oxygen to their tissues even if the fish isn't moving very much. And that's unlike sharks, which have to swim with their mouth open to push water over their gills.
Interesting.
Yeah, so it's really that operculum is only found in these bony fish and is a pretty important evolutionary adaptation.
Also, right behind here, all these little scales and stuff, is that?
Yeah, and then another kind of thing, you can almost, some of these, we can almost flick them off here. Here's one.
Oh, yeah.
You can flick off there. So these scales are very, very thin, almost transparent, but they are made of bone. They're a very thin type of bone that's thinned down. And they actually lie underneath the skin, so there's a very thin layer of epidermis that lies over the top of those bony scales. But over time, some of the earlier fish, you think of like gars and things like that, have these big, heavy scales. These ray fin fish, many of them have these lighter scales that then allow them to be more buoyant and more maneuverable in the water. So they sacrifice protection for weight.
Sure. You mentioned they're buoyant. That's something we're looking for too right away.
Yeah, we'll look for. Yeah, they have a swim bladder inside them. Things are, so they're very. We'll take a look at that in just a second.
Anything else before we start cutting into it? Or?
I don't think so. It's mostly the external anatomy. You can see they have a basic, what's called fusiform or streamline shape for moving through the water pretty easily. The tail pushes side to side and provides that motion. So they're swimming machines. They're very well adapted for pushing through the water, and with the gills for extracting oxygen, it's not surprising that they're such a successful group of animals.
I have to ask one more question about before we move on here. I know some of the last dissections we did, regeneration, so if these, we pass that
phase now? You're pretty much past that phase. Most of these, once a limb or a structure is lost, skin will regrow, and bone will even grow up to a certain point, but you're not, they
like
don't have regeneration.
In the past with some other stuff.
Okay. Yeah.